Whose voice was first sounded in this land? What has been done to my country I did not want? Did not ask for it. White people going through my country. Red Cloud, Oglala Chief. We were once friends with the whites, but you nudged us out of your way by your intrigues. Why don't you talk and go straight and let all be well? Black Kettle, Cheyenne Chief. It was not we who made war upon the English, but the English who, without notice, made war upon us. Canonicus, Narragansett Sachem.
Now, don't forget, you're talking Indian things here. I want to make it clear, as I've tried to qualify before, when we go out there on the street, the law of the land applies to everyone. You, me, and everyone, and it has to be respected. I've never deviated from that. Never. And I never will. But when you talk about Indian things and the history of what's happened to my people, as opposed to, or including why it happened, and as opposed to some of our attitudes, then you have to understand this long history on this.
The first recorded contact between the Narragansett and the European explorers took place in 1524.
The people are the most beautiful and have the most civil customs that we have found on this voyage. They are taller than we are, the face is clear cut, the eyes are black and alert, and their manner is sweet and gentle. Giovanni de Verrazzano.
Nearly a century later, the Chacoquac, or swordmen, landed in Plymouth and began to claim the land as their own. In 1636, Roger Williams, a political outcast from the Massachusetts Bay Colony, arrived in Narragansett territory. According to legend, he was greeted by the Narragansett with the words, "What cheer, Netop," the Narragansett word for friend. This historic meeting has inspired stories, paintings, and even a silent film. Roger Williams was one of the few colonists who believed that the Native Americans were the rightful owners of the New World. He criticized those Christians who felt they had a God-given right to seize what they called heathen lands. As more settlers arrived, anger at the intruders grew stronger. Hostilities, which had simmered for decades, erupted in June of 1675. War broke out between the Wampanoag and the United Colonies of Massachusetts Bay, Plymouth, Connecticut, and New Haven. To finance the campaign, captured Wampanoag were sold into slavery and shipped to the West Indies. Some fled to Rhode Island, which had vowed to remain neutral. But the English ordered the Narragansett Sachem, Canonchet, to turn over all refugees. No, he told them. Not a Wampanoag, nor the paring of a Wampanoag's nail. The United Colonies declared war on the Narragansetts and sent an army into southern Rhode Island. The troops struggled through an area called the Great Swamp till they reached the hidden stronghold of the Narragansett. The soldiers overcame the defenders and stormed the fortified island that served as a refuge for hundreds of women, children, and old men. Once inside, they quickly put the wigwams to the torch.
The shrieks and cries of the women and children, the yelling of the warriors, exhibited a most horrible and appalling scene, so that it greatly moved some of the soldiers. They were in much doubt, and they afterwards seriously inquired whether burning their enemies alive could be consistent with humanity and the benevolent principle of the gospel. The Reverend William Ruggles.
Oh, I think it was a massacre. You know, I don't think there could be any question about that, because the English troops went much further than they had to do to take that place, to take that land. They didn't have to torch the wigwams, they didn't have to kill the women and children. So I think in that regard, it was a massacre.
Those who survived the slaughter, attacked the towns of Warwick, Seekonk, and Providence, burning houses and often killing the inhabitants. In April of 1676, the colonial army captured Canonchet and immediately sentenced him to be executed. "I like it well," he told his captors. "I shall die before my heart is soft, or I have said anything unworthy of myself." The great sachem was shot, his body hacked into quarters, and his severed head put on public display. When the war ended, the remaining Narragansetts merged with the Niantic, settling in the area now called Charlestown. The Rhode Island colony assumed jurisdiction over all native territory within its boundaries. The Narragansett nation was eventually squeezed into a 30-square-mile tract of land. Over the next 100 years, this domain was further reduced as sachems, in collusion with Rhode Island legislators, sold Narragansett land to pay off personal debts. By the late 19th century, pressure to be assimilated into the cultural mainstream was being brought to bear on Native Americans across the country. In 1879, the state of Rhode Island initiated a proposal to sell off the Narragansett's remaining land and officially abolish the nation. After conducting hearings, a commission determined that 324 men, women, and children could claim tribal membership. Each individual was given $16.56 as a payment for their share of the land.
All of the tribal people did not agree because that they got a number who thought or they agreed, and they did have a couple of the tribal leaders, but not all of them. This was done, but the thing is that all of us have suffered because of that. But it was not a unanimous decision, and it did not follow the tribal procedure at that time. So every law was broken, and it still is not accepted as of today.
On August 20th, 1883, the state officially concluded the detribalization of the Narragansett Nation with a public ceremony at Fort Ninegrip. The centerpiece of the event was a stone taken from the reservation bearing the words, "Memorial of the Narragansett Indians, the unwavering friends and allies of our fathers." Governor Augustus Bourne addressed the crowd.
"I trust that as enduring as this granite may be the recollection in the minds of the people of Rhode Island of the debt of gratitude which they owe to the Narragansett Indians." Governor Augustus Bourne.
Neither the monument nor the illegal actions of the state would withstand the test of time.
The struggle to regain tribal lands when our neighbors, the Narragansetts, continues.
South Dakota, 1913. Members of the 7th Cavalry arrive at the Pine Ridge Reservation. They are here to observe members of the Oglala Nation sign a declaration of allegiance to the United States of America. Officially called Carrying the Flag and a Message of Hope to a Vanishing Race, this ritual will be repeated on reservations across the country. Native American submission to government authority is dramatized in stark and often crudely staged scenes. President William Howard Taft personally attends the grand finale, the dedication of the American Indian Memorial at Fort Wadsworth, New York. Tribal elders, some of whom fought against Custer, are paraded before the cameras, compelling evidence in the eyes of some that the final conquest of the American Indian is now complete. But like a smoldering fire, the spirit of these nations refused to be extinguished. Despite detribalization, the Narragansetts continued to make their presence known. Some chose to join the ranks of modern society. Others believed that assimilation could only lead to ruin.
By then, there were people who knew the game, had long since become familiar with the game that was being played. The Narragansett families who wished to remain traditionally as their ancestors had been made sure there was the teaching. Go out there and learn all that you can from these people. But never forget who you are. Never forget you have your own language, your own religion, and your own way of acceptance.
In Rhode Island, some citizens who did not own property had to wait until 1928 before they were granted voting rights. But three groups were still officially barred by state law from casting a ballot: paupers, the mentally incompetent, and Indians. The only way the Narragansetts could participate in elections was by identifying themselves as African Americans. Charles Ernest Hazard confronted officials who enforced this practice. His brother, Joseph, one of the oldest members of the Narragansett Nation, recalls the moment.
Indians couldn't vote, so he went up to the State House and he says, it's on the charter that the Indians can't vote. And he says, you vote, nature? And he says, no. He says, I consider myself a Narragansett Indian. If I vote, I'm voting under Negroes could vote, but not an Indian. And he said, I consider myself a Narragansett, not a black, so I'd like to have that changed. So they did.
In 1950, after a series of delays and debates, the Narragansett were finally granted the right to vote. Despite the loss of nearly all their land, the Narragansett continued to gather together as a nation on the second Sunday of each August, a tradition with roots deep in their past.
The biggest thing that we always looked for, we called it the August meeting. I mean, nowadays they call it the powwow and like that, but we always call it the August meeting. The idea was to get together, socialize, exchange ideas with one another, and, you know, pass on the local gossip and things that we'd heard from out from, that drifted across from the West or the Midwest, or anything was news in them days because news travels so slow. Anything you heard was a big event.
Oh, it's a great time to see old friends because people come from all over the United States to come back for August meeting. If you're away, you will always take your vacation, and not always, but you know, most of the time. I know I lived in California for a few years and in Michigan, and I always took my vacation to come home for August meeting. It was a thing of unity, and it was a thing of acknowledging that we have survived.
But the outside world could not be held at bay for long. A few weeks after these carefree gatherings, the children of the Narragansetts had to return to school. Re-education was the cornerstone of the government's attempt to absorb Native Americans into the mainstream. By the turn of the 20th century, there were over 100 federal boarding schools in operation. Discipline was strict. Native children were not allowed to use their language, wear traditional clothing, or practice their religion. The sons and daughters of the Narragansetts faced a far different problem. After detribalization, the old Indian schoolhouse in Charlestown was officially closed, and the children sent to public schools.
Well, we're a minority anyway, and I was a minor minority, is the way it seemed to me. It seemed like I'd be just the only one in my class, or sometimes in the whole school. So, I mean, things were some trying, sometimes difficult. You know how kids are, sometimes they can be a little miserable and sometimes pick on you and call names and things like that. But, I mean, as the old saying, sticks and stones will hurt my bones, but names never hurt me. It's just one of those things, you know, nothing serious.
Native students were often confronted by history lessons that contradicted the teachings of Narragansett elders.
Like during history class, I remember sitting there and shaking my head, you know, a teacher looking at me. I said, no, I'll let you know to myself, I'm telling, letting her know. Nah, that's not right, that's not right. You know, that's not how it went, because I do know my history, you know what I mean? So I don't know, what she was saying was not right. Then if I corrected, of course, you know, I got sent out in the hall, you know, because I was interfering.
In the popular arts of the early 1900s, dime novels, Wild West shows, and silent movies, Native Americans were frequently typecast as treacherous savages threatening innocent white settlers. Time and again, a people whose own way of life had been brutally assaulted were portrayed as villains.
What I would see in the movies, I was wondering if there would ever be any Indians left when I grew up, because every movie I ever saw, even in silent movies and stuff like that, which I've seen, seemed like all the Indians was dying. And the treaties were being broken and everything, and somebody would cross them up and didn't keep the word, and the first thing you know, a few would be wiped out here and there, and that was one thing in my mind. I wonder if anything will be left when I do grow up. It just makes you tough and rugged, and you can take anything that's thrown at you. At least, speaking for myself, that's the way it's worked for me.
The 1920s marked the beginning of what historians call the Pan-Indian Movement. In essence, it refers to a growing sense of pride in the common heritage shared by all nations. It coincided with a renewed effort by the Narragansetts to reassert their nation's identity. During the height of this new awareness, a champion emerged whose name would become synonymous with the Narragansett Nation. Tarzan Brown's speed and determination as a track star brought international fame and recognition to the Narragansetts. But friends and family recall the lighter moments in the life of this proud young man, who could run like the wind.
My mother could never find him because he's always running. And he ran by the house one day, and my sister said, "Mom, Allison's out there running down the road with his underpants on." She said, we didn't know, with old fashioned, he didn't wear short pants and things in them days, like, with his underpants on. She said, "You go tell him to that young man, he marched right in here." And my sister chased him all the way down to the corner and told him, "Mom wants you to come right back home." But he kept right on running. He was training, but we didn't know that.
I used to train with that guy all the time. And we'd run down through Wessing, come around through Bradford, go about 12, 15 miles or something like that. Anyhow, he says, "Gee," he says, "you ought to come in one of the races with me," he says, "because I could come in first and you could come in second." He said, "I can tell." I said to myself, "What do you mean you go first? I'll be first," like that. And the gun went off. Those guys took off and they went up this hill, and I looked, and they were going around the corner, and that's the last I seen of any of them. That's the last of my running.
In the 50s, the August meetings continued, but a new element was added. Sparked by television's fascination with the Old West, carloads of visitors arrived, eager to catch a glimpse of the Narragansetts. The Narragansetts appeared to tolerate this sudden burst of curiosity with patience and dignity. In the 60s, Native Americans across the country became increasingly vocal in their demands for justice. By the early 70s, the situation had reached the boiling point. In November of 1972, members of AIM, the American Indian Movement, seized the headquarters of the Bureau of Indian Affairs in Washington, D.C. For many of the protesters, the Bureau had become a symbol of government indifference and corruption. The following year, armed members of AIM took over the village of Wounded Knee on the Pine Ridge Reservation in South Dakota. The action captured worldwide attention and led to demonstrations of support across the country.
These are students from Rhode Island College, Brown University, ALP High School, a number of concerned people who are coming out in support of what's happening at Wounded Knee. People feel very concerned about the oppression, first of all, of American Indians. And they feel that the demands of AIM are quite justified, and they're coming out in support, just basically to support that action.
It was an exciting time. It was a disturbing time. The big confrontation at Wounded Knee took place, and I dearly wanted to go. Oh, I wanted to go. I had made arrangements for my three children to parcel them out so that I could go out there and join these people. And my parents said it wasn't fair to my children. Anything could happen. And as it was, one woman from New England was killed out there. But in that period of time is when I finally grew up enough to listen to my father and become more involved myself in tribal issues, attending the meetings, having a voice in saying what we're going to do with our future.
In Plymouth, Massachusetts, a Thanksgiving protest shocked visiting tourists and challenged comfortable beliefs about the meaning of the holiday.
They killed off anyone who resisted. And they killed all our spiritual leaders. Well, we've stopped forgiving now. And this is why we want to put the spirits of our dead at rest and make a circle of unity.
In January of 1975, the Narragansetts filed suit for the return of 3,200 acres of land in southern Rhode Island. They charged that the state violated the law when it sold Narragansett territory without approval from the federal government.
They took everything from us through one means or another. They took everything and have been extremely reluctant to yield anything back, even when federal law clearly proved that the law had been broken, that these people had, that Rhode Island, the powers that be in Rhode Island, had violated the law. They stole the final tribally owned lands and then flourished their pens and said the tribe no longer existed. Totally illegal.
Legal assistance was provided to the Narragansetts by the Native American Rights Fund. In their view, both the method and the motive of the General Assembly were all too familiar.
Well, it was happening in the 1800s and then continued up right to the late 1950s, where a tribe was essentially no longer recognized, and the people were usually given a sum of money and their tribal lands taken and then sold. The motivation is actually quite simple. They wanted Indian people, their culture, their lifestyle, their religion, to disappear like they tried to make the buffalo disappear.
The case was settled out of court when the state agreed to give the Narragansetts 1,800 acres of land in Charlestown. Federal legislation finalized the settlement.
Well, I think we did what was right at the right time. And everybody in the state of Rhode Island, I think, was sensitive to the concerns of the Indians and whether or not this land was rightfully or wrongfully conveyed. So I think we, with good faith, tried to settle that. And I would have to say that the Indians acted in the same way. And it was to Rhode Island's credit.
The Rhode Island Indian Claims Settlement Act was a major victory for the Narragansetts. But it held the seeds of a future dispute, one that would grow to overshadow the hopes of those who negotiated in good faith to address the transgressions of the past.
Federal recognition of the Narragansett Nation when Our Neighbors, the Narragansetts, continues.
After the Settlement Act, the Narragansetts set their sights on their next goal, federal recognition.
We always had recognition. What we were seeking was re-recognition and acknowledgement. The acknowledgement that would make us eligible for the over 300 programs where Indians could receive funding for the programs that they had. And that was the purpose of the acknowledgement.
In 1983, after years of effort, the United States formally recognized the Narragansetts as a sovereign nation.
Oh, it was just a nice feeling. I remember getting the news on the at August meeting, and some of us threw up our hats, and we were yelling and screaming. It was kind of nice to think all that, and they finally do realize, well, we are a tribe, and we are Eastern Indians, and there are Eastern Indians.
The August meetings continue to this day. Activities such as traditional dance contests attract members from other nations and a wide assortment of onlookers.
Well, first of all, the August meeting is, originally it was a family gathering. And when we were being encroached upon and our properties were being stolen from us from residents of the state and estate, the only safe haven that was available for us to go and do our ceremonial And our spiritual type of gatherings was right in that one little location, which is now referred to as the Narragansett Long Meeting House or Indian Church. That piece of property has never been in the hands of anybody other than Narragansett people. One of the very small pieces that we managed to retain.
You've got to be able to fight for who you are. You have to respect who you are, and you have to love your heritage. You have to know where your roots are, and you have to live like that. No matter what anyone else does.
The greatest feeling of all is to go down by the Indian church and to touch the ground and know that that ground has never, ever belonged to anyone but us. We've been here 30,000 years, and I think we'll be here in another 30,000 years.
Like any ethnic group celebrating its cultural history, a gathering of contemporary Native Americans presents an audience with a mixture of the old and the new. Prescription sunglasses grace the painted faces of tribal elders. Handmade bracelets and gold wristwatches adorn the same arm. Regalia, the buckskins, beads, and feathered headdresses worn at such special occasions, are often based on historic garments of Western nations. Appropriating a style of dress that is easily recognized as Native American has become a common practice in recent times.
Now, everyone knows that it would have been senseless for in the forested areas for the people to run around with great feathered bonnets. However, they are beautiful. And for celebration and for decoration, it's fine to have evolved to the point where you would want to wear it. So it's just an evolution and an adoption of things of beauty.
Gatherings like the August meeting are often the first time that the public has the opportunity to meet the Narragansetts. The sensitive issue of race can arise when outsiders arrive with preconceived notions of what an American Indian should look like.
A person is who they identify themselves as. It is not what's in their bloodstream, it's what's in their heart and how they feel. People want to get into ethnicity or racism, that's their problem. I think the tribe has a right to identify who their members are, as with all nations. And we, as in the United States, is the greatest example of that. So my people are my people, regardless as to who they are.
The years following federal recognition of the Narragansetts were times of transition and tribulation. Federal funds were a tremendous boost to a group of people whose average incomes were well below the poverty level. But these new resources and the administrative responsibilities associated with them caused problems for the Narragansetts.
Oh, sure, there were growing pains. I can't be used to having a nickel and making it go in 1,000 directions, and suddenly somebody gives me $20. That's a growing process. I can't be expected to know what to do with that $20 because I hardly knew what to do with that nickel. So how do you suddenly, just overnight, just expect me to know what to do with that $20? It doesn't work that way.
The results of a tribal election were contested. Friction increased between members who identified with traditional customs and those who had become more assimilated into the non-native mainstream.
It wasn't good times for the Narragansetts. We really didn't choose to go the way things went at the time. It was something that was just placed upon us. We had to make some very fast decisions on our feet. Some of us literally put our lives on the line in defense of our people and our rights.
An argument over which faction had the right to use a tribal vehicle led to an ugly confrontation with the police outside a Narragansett meeting house.
I have no problem defending who I am and what I am and defend the rights of my people. If I have to be arrested in defense of my people, I'll go to jail every day of the week. We're not about to lay down and roll over, and we're not about to allow an outsider to come in and dictate who we are and what we are and how we're going to maintain our internal controls.
Media attention that focused on divisions within the nation was deeply resented by many of the Narragansetts.
You know, they say Columbus discovered America. He came over here and landed on the graves of my people. So he was not the first American. So it's like,
You know, they're always talking about how we argue among themselves. Do they ever tell us how they argue among themselves? And I know they do because I've been out there. And I know.
Today, the Narragansetts seem to have come to terms with many of the problems that divided them in the past.
As families disagree with issues, so does a tribe. But there isn't that division now, and that's just a sign of, you know, a tribe coming together as you would hope a tribe would be, and a community being a community, and we're moving forward together again as best as possible.
Tangible evidence of cooperative effort, such as the construction and dedication of a federally funded Indian Health Center, is celebrated by all.
Hooray for this great day!
But the struggle for acceptance and respect is by no means over. Members of the Narragansett Nation can still be the targets of racial slurs and bigotry.
It's very upsetting to read in the media the negativity about our people, the racism which is rampant in this state against the Narragansett. It breaks my heart because I love every piece of this ground. I've lived all over the United States. I keep coming back to Rhode Island because this is home. This is the land my parents taught me to love.
Membership in the Narragansett Nation is determined in large part by the tribal role of the 1880s.
Right now, we're going by the 1880 to 1884 rolls. So you have a grandparent on the rolls. Well, you know, you got to prove that that is your grandparent. You know, a grandparent or great-great, of course. You know, they have to prove, you know, to us that that is their grandparent. So apparently, it comes right down to the line to their mother and right onto them, you know. So they have to prove this, you know.
Deciding who may claim membership and who may not has become a thorny issue for many nations, including the Narragansetts.
We have a lot of them that can't prove it and has been on the rolls, you know. So that's a kind of a sticky issue at this point, you know. But, we haven't had no too much backlash on it just yet, but I suppose it's coming, you know.
In the 18th century, some of the Narragansett converted to Christianity. A granite church was built in the heart of the Charlestown Reservation. It stood for more than a century until 1993, when it became the victim of a suspicious fire. The church was rebuilt and rededicated 3 years later. Hundreds of natives and non-natives attended a service led by the Narragansett's dynamic minister, the Reverend Roland Mars.
On behalf of the Narragansett Indian Church, we'd like to welcome you here. The woods welcome you. The animals welcome you, and so do we. God knows all of his people. He made us all. And had it only been done right the first time, we'd all been friends from the beginning. And we've been in these woods for many years. Extend the hand of fellowship to us. Visit us. You will get to know us, and if allowed, you're going to have more love on your hand than you can handle. If you give me time, I'll show you how to find it. We want to thank you and God bless you.
A shared sense of faith and goodwill with the outside world is important to many of the Narragansetts. But hidden deep in the collective memory of the Narragansett people, there are scars that will never heal.
Yo, kayu inesh ni kambwa Narragansett.
Each year, the Narragansett solemnly draw together in the shadow of a granite monument and pay homage to the victims of the Great Swamp Massacre.
It's almost like you can hear the old people crying and wailing. It's a very sad thing, that a hurtful thing. They waited until the water froze over so that they could go in when they were hiding, and these were all elderly people and children. And they just went in, and to me, they murdered them. And that's, you know, it makes a real sad, hard feeling in my heart that anybody could do this.
Our people have always had to deal with the madness of those people who came across in that European invasion. Everywhere they entered, they had to conquer. and to take over.
Some members of the Narragansett Nation feel strongly that attacks on the Narragansetts did not end in the 17th century. They believe that new battles are being fought today, in courtrooms, in corporate offices, and even in the halls of Congress.
It's very important that we as a people do not forget who and what we are. For the white men who listen, or anyone else, I will say this. As the battle rages around us, so does the battle rage within. Look at your first fire. See the signs. The strength in dealing with that battle must come from within.
The controversy over Indian gaming, when our neighbors, the Narragansetts, continues. In 1979, members of the Seminole Nation opened a commercial bingo establishment on their reservation. Encouraged by its success, other nations across the country began their own gambling ventures. Conflicts soon erupted among state, federal, and tribal governments regarding the jurisdiction over these facilities.
It became obvious from the very moment that if nothing was done, it would be absolute chaos. Because the natural consequence would be tribes looking at this as a God-given opportunity and without any rules, supervision, regulations, start putting it up, and obviously you will have violence on both sides.
To solve this problem, Congress passed the Indian Gaming Regulatory Act, known as IGRA.
The initial step that the committee took, or the Congress took, was to look upon the relationship of Indians and the government, and it's a government-to-government relationship, federal and tribes. It's not state and tribes.
The Indian Claims Act of 1978 stated that settlement land would be subject to the laws of Rhode Island, and state law prohibited the establishment of a gaming facility without voter approval. Senators Claiborne Pell and John Chafee attempted to add an amendment to IGRA that would prevent it from overriding the Rhode Island Settlement Act.
Senator Pell wanted to insert an amendment that said, we want to make it very clear, this does not abrogate the agreement that has been entered into in Rhode Island and has been codified in federal law.
But Senator Daniel Inouye, chairman of the Senate Indian Affairs Committee, was opposed to adding such an amendment.
Obviously, if we accepted that and put that into bill language, then we knew the consequences would be no bill.
There's no doubt in your mind. Look.
No doubt.
The amendment was withdrawn before passage of the bill, but Senator Inouye allowed a formal discussion of its content, known as colloquy, in the committee's final report. When the Narragansetts announced their intention to open a gambling facility, Rhode Island filed a lawsuit to stop them. The state offered the Senate colloquy as evidence that the Settlement Act, not the Indian Gaming Regulatory Act, should apply to the Narragansetts. But a federal court ruled in favor of the Narragansetts and issued a strongly worded decision. Once Congress has spoken, it is bound by what it has plainly said, notwithstanding the nods and winks that may have been exchanged in floor debates and committee hearings.
In other words, contrary to what Senator Inouye indicated, the Gaming Act did change very key provisions of the Rhode Island Land Claims Settlement Act.
After the court decision, Senators Pell and Chafee made one last attempt to amend the Indian Gaming Regulatory Act. But by then, the chairman of the Senate Indian Affairs Committee had experienced a change of heart.
I did have some regrets because by having that colloquy, it did add confusion, true confusion. Since the colloquy, I had the opportunity to look into it, and I realized that, as I said publicly, that I think my position was wrong.
Following the federal court's decision, Rhode Island Governor Bruce Sundland entered into negotiations with the Narragansetts. A referendum that would allow the Narragansetts to build a casino on non-tribal land was placed on the ballot. Several other gambling ventures backed by private investors were also proposed. All were rejected by the voters.
The citizens of the state of Rhode Island have spoken clearly on this subject, and I think their views are of some consequence.
Under the Indian Gaming Regulatory Act, states must allow Native nations to offer the same form of gambling on their land that is legal within that state. And Rhode Island is no stranger to gambling. Gross annual sales by its lottery commission have totaled nearly $500 million in recent years. The Narragansetts proposed building a gaming facility on their property. But Rhode Island's new governor, Lincoln Aumann, refused to negotiate with them, citing his opposition to gambling. The tribe feels the governor's position is hypocritical because the state relies on revenues from lotteries, video poker, dog racing, keno, and other games of chance.
We just visited the governor with a zero tolerance pledge and asked him, challenged him to take a zero tolerance stance on gaming dollars coming into the state coffers and the state budget. And to date, the governor hasn't given us an official response, but it stands to reason he won't sign it because he's reliant too much on those gaming dollars. That's a fine example of what the tribe was intending to do with its gaming dollars within establishing on the reservation. As much as he's relying upon those dollars to take care of whatever budget issues or needs that come up in the state, that's what we were going to do with our people.
Governor Aumann continues to oppose gambling on Narragansett lands. He declined to be interviewed for this program. The Supreme Court chose not to review Rhode Island's appeal against the Narragansetts, thereby allowing the federal court ruling to stand. The Narragansetts had won their case. Unable to amend the Indian Gaming Regulatory Act, Senator Chafee employed a new course of action. Chafee's target was the Settlement Act, a compact negotiated between the Narragansetts and the state of Rhode Island almost 20 years earlier.
It's my understanding that one party of that contract cannot unilaterally change the language, particularly if the other party didn't default. Enough said. I've said what I wanted to say.
Well, no, because I just think what we did was not only fair and accurate, it reinforced what everybody had originally agreed to.
Chafee attached an amendment to a major federal spending bill which read, "For purposes of the Indian Gaming Regulatory Act, settlement lands shall not be treated as Indian lands."
We're engaging in a double standard here with our Narragansett tribe, and they're the only tribe in this country in this conference report that's singled out like this. We had no hearings on this issue in the Natural Resources Committee. I think it's a really discriminatory measure for us to say it's all right for us to game, provide for our people, but at the same time saying, no, Native Americans, we're not going to allow you to do what we're doing ourselves.
The spending bill passed, and with it, Chafee's amendment. The Narragansetts were outraged.
So I think we should all saddle up and ride over to Chafee's office right now and let him know how we feel.
Huh? You know, you have a right, and suddenly it's taken away because I don't like you having that right. That's basically how it was done. I don't agree with you having that right. I have the ability to change the law. I'll change the law. Is this fair?
New court rulings have clouded the future of Indian gaming, leading some to pin their hopes on the possibility of intervention by the Secretary of the Interior.
How many of you would like to hear a nice, long 30-minute speech?
But Bruce Babbitt has shown little interest in risky political action.
I'm delighted to be here. You all have a good evening. Thank you.
Opposition to the Narragansett's plans are not limited to politicians. Local groups say they fear the impact that a gaming facility might have on their community.
Well, I'm concerned about conservation in South County. After the state enacted the Zoning Enabling Act in 1991, it allows communities to take a much stronger role in protecting natural resources. And that would all have no meaning if at the center of town you have a huge commercial operation.
The idea that Charlestown residents are concerned about overdevelopment seems ironic to some of the Narragansetts.
If people are concerned, people fly by night, people that blow in and out on the wind, if they're concerned about Charleston, then just imagine how the tribe, some whose families never left this area, imagine how they felt with the intrusion of all the non-Indians that have come into the Charleston area.
And we give you this with our great love.
There are those who count themselves as friends of the Narragansetts who have spoken out against the idea of gambling on tribal land.
We feel that the voice of the church has needed to be raised on that. And we're saying to the Native Americans, my God, why do you want that? Why do you want that? Because it is going to affect the very values that have been the most enriching from your culture and your religious faith to us. It's gonna kill you.
Despite such pleas, the Narragansetts say they will continue to challenge legal obstacles, which they argue have little to do with gambling and everything to do with tribal sovereignty.
Okay, land settlement was a vehicle for conflict. Recognition was a vehicle for conflict. Housing was a vehicle for conflict. Any kind of development, building or anything, a vehicle for conflict, right? So this recent thing on gaming, merely a vehicle for conflict to challenge a sovereignty and to impose jurisdiction upon the Narragansetts.
Over 500 Native nations have been recognized as sovereign nations by the federal government. That special status is difficult for many non-Native citizens to accept. But experts point out that this unique relationship was forged early in the history of the Republic.
It's in the Constitution. It's part of the many decisions of the Supreme Court. It's been legislated upon time and again. Sovereignty is very clear. Now, they've paid a heavy price for this. We seem to forget that they were here long before we got here, and that's their land.
Some of the Narragansetts feel that racism is the hidden force that motivates those who oppose their plans.
When you have people that are predominantly of one race, and you have an Indian tribe, and every action of the powers that be in a state are trying to thwart whatever the tribe tries to do, regardless how legal the tribe's actions are, then that's racist. Give me the logic behind widespread gambling that exists in the state, but yet the tribe can't do it because they are an Indian tribe.
But opponents of gambling like Senator Chafee, whose record on civil rights is unblemished, dismiss such accusations.
People can make all kinds of ridiculous charges, but thank goodness the people of the state of Rhode Island are pretty thoughtful and pretty, they don't go for that.
Chafee's amendment remains law, and those who might seek to repeal it are not optimistic about their chances.
At this moment, I don't think the votes are there in the Congress. I know the Indians have waited a long time, but and I think they'll continue to wait a long time more. I'm sorry to say that.
Yet despite the odds against them, the Narragansett Nation remains undaunted.
Yeah, you get frustrated, but some of the battles we're fighting are minor compared to the battles of our ancestors, and perhaps no one can predict the future, but who knows what kind of future fights might be for the tribal leaders of the future. We have to carry forward regardless of the frustrations, and that's a task we're charged with, as not only tribal government people, but Narragansett people. If it's in your blood, if you're a Narragansett member, then you can't let the frustrations get the best of you, because then you've been defeated.
A look into the future of the tribe when Our Neighbors, the Narragansetts, continues.
What tomorrow will bring for the Narragansett Nation remains to be seen. Despite the current controversy, leaders emphasize that gaming and the wealth it might provide are not the most important factors in their future.
Whether this tribe moves forth with gaming or not is irrelevant. But what we must protect is what is rightfully ours through congressional laws or through our own inherent laws. We realize that we all need money to exist in this world today, and all we're doing is looking to provide a better lifestyle in the areas of health, education, and welfare for our people. If this gaming thing is something that can do that, fine. If there's other opportunities so we can provide a lifestyle that is comparable to mainstream for our people, then that's good too. But when you look at all the statistics dealing with Indian people, we sit at the bottom of that totem pole in every respect.
Ultimately, what the Narragansetts are seeking from the rest of society may be more fundamental in nature.
I would say to look at us as human beings, not much different than anyone else, maybe a little different in color, but we have some that are educated, we have some that are not educated, we have some that are perfectly wonderful gentlemen and ladies, we have some that are not, but we are just exactly like any other group of people. I think that's what they should look at, and that we have been here forever. Not came from here, there, or anywhere, we were here. I think that should be brought into their mind, that most everybody came here, and we were here. And I think those that deserve respect should get it.
In recent years, the Narragansetts have added their voice to a chorus of other Native nations, seeking a new relationship of trust and mutual respect between their people and the United States. There are those who will question whether such a relationship should even exist, yet few can deny that there are voices calling for change, and those voices are growing stronger.